Namaste ji.
Namaste. Please mute your mic, ma'am. We're going to start the class now. Om Vaktardanda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvigdham Kurme Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada Saraswati Namastubhyam Varadhe Kamarupini Vidyarambham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatu Me Sada Murave Sarvalokanam Vishaje Bhavarohinam Nidaye Sarvavidyanam Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Ishvaro Guru Atmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Garunalayam Namami Bhagavat Padam Shankaram Loka Shankaram Sada Shiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Sakshat Krutam Dayanandam Paramartha Swarupinam Tatvajnana Prashastaram Pranatosmi Parampadam Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvina Vadhetamastu Mavidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 Now after the Shanti Mantra, we will chant Dhyana Shloka. I will chant, you can keep your mic in mute and chant. Om Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Gratitam Purana Munina Madhye Mahabharatam Advaitamrita Varshinim Bhagavatim Ashtadashadhyayinim Ambatvavanusandadhani Bhagavad-gite Bhavadveshinim Namostu te vyasa vishala buddhe ullara vindaya tapatra netra enatvaya bharata taila purnaha prajvalito jnanamaya pradipaha prapanna parijataya Tra-vetraika-pa-nai Jnana-mudraya-krishnaya Gita-mrata-duhe namaha Sarva-panishado-gavaha Dogdha-gopala-nandhanaha Partho-vatsa-sudhir-bhokta Duktam Gita Vratam Mahat Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanura Mardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Bhishma Drona Tata Jayadrata Jala Gandharani Lotpala శల్యగ్రాహవతి కృపేణ వహని కర్ణేన వేలాకులా అశ్వత్థామ వికర్ణ ఘోరమకరా దుర్యోధనావర్తిని సోతీర్ణా ఖలు పాండవైరణ నదీ కైవర్తక కేశవ. పారాశర్యవచ సరోజమమలం గీతార్థగంధోత్కటం నానాఖ్యానకేసరం హరికథా సంబోధనాబోధితం లోకే సజ్జన షట్పదైరహరహః తే పీయమానం ముదా భూయాద్ భారత పంకజం కలిమల ప్రత్వంసిన శ్రేయసే మూకం కరోతి వాచాలం పంగుం లంఘయతే గిరిం యత్ కృపాత్తమహం వందే పరమానంద మాధవం యం బ్రహ్మా వరుణేంద్ర రుద్ర మరుతః స్తుంవంతి దివ్యైస్తవైః వేదైః సాంగ పద క్రమోపనిషదైః గాయంతి యం సామగాః ధ్యానావస్థిత తద్గతేన మనసా పశ్యంతి యం యోగినః యస్యాంతం న విదుః సురాసురగణాః దేవాయ తస్మై నమః. Is my voice clear or not? Is it disconnected? If it is disconnected, then nothing can be done, because this is the only connection I have now. So we have to stop it here.
It is manageable, Ji.
It's good. We can hear you fine.
It is good.
Yeah, I'm getting messages and WhatsApp. So I'm replying to it and at the same time doing class both. So difficult. So if it is okay, we will
continue. No, this is not. Yeah, it's okay, Saranji.
Okay. There may be a problem, I know, but nothing can be done. This is what Bhagavan has given now. So we have to manage with this. If this is okay for all of you, I can continue.
Yeah, it's okay. We shall try.
It's okay, Saranji.
Yeah, okay. We will proceed.
Okay.
We can.
I was finding it difficult to answer to the WhatsApp message and taking classes also parallelly. Anyway, so we'll continue. Okay. Fine. Narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam దేవీం సరస్వతీం వ్యాసం తతో జయముదీరయేత్. దిస్ శ్లోక ఇస్ ది మంగళ శ్లోక ఆఫ్ మహాభారత. ఐ డోంట్ నో వెదర్ ఐ సెడ్ దిస్ ఇస్ ది శ్లోక విచ్ ఇస్ ఇన్ ది ఇంట్రొడక్షన్ టు ది భాష్యం. ఇఫ్ ఐ సెడ్ దట్ ప్లీజ్ కరెక్ట్ ఇట్. ఇట్ ఈస్ ది ధ్యాన శ్లోక ఆఫ్ ది మహాభారతం. భగవత్పద స్టార్ట్స్ విత్ another shloka that I will teach you later. So this is narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvatim vyasam tato jaya mudirayet. Okay, so in the last class I was telling the story of mahabharatam up to bhishma parva. We saw. And in the Bhishma Parva, Parva means section. There are 18 Parvas in Mahabharatam. In Bhishma Parva alone, the teaching of Bhagavad Gita is located. So through the story, now we have come to the context. We have come to the Parva, Bhishma Parva, where the Gita teaching is going to be started. Now, everybody has assembled in the Kurukshetra, the battlefield. Lord Krishna is going to give Upadesha to Arjuna in the midst of the battlefield, Kurukshetra. Kurukshetra is a battlefield. And Kurukshetra is a place, it's a place in North India where the battle took place. Mahabharatam is not a fiction. Mahabharatam, some people say it is a fiction. So it is a war between the good and the bad. It's a war between the Pandava and the Kaurava. It's nothing but the war which happens inside everybody's heart between the good and the other. Otherwise, good. Otherwise, I mean bad. I don't want to use evil at all. Good and the bad. But it is it can be symbolically presented like as a war between the good and the bad, but it has historical significance also. That is why it is called Itihasa. 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 Asa is, this is how it happened. Of course, there are imaginations of Vyasacharya also there. Ramayana and Mahabharata, both are Itihasa. There are some imaginations of the author. That is the contribution of the author. But it's all historical facts. It happened. The war happened. Mahabharata happened. And the place where it happened was Kurukshetra. And Kurukshetra, it is significant for two reasons. One reason, the great historical battle. The great historical battle took place in Kurukshetra. That is one. And Lord Krishna, as the guru, he gave the teaching of Bhagavad Gita to his disciple Arjuna in that same place. Therefore, it has twin significance. One is the battle took place in that very place, in that Kurukshetra, and it was a place where the great teaching was given by Arjuna, but given by Krishna to his disciple Arjuna. Arjuna had not yet become disciple. Now he is in the chariot, holding his Gandiva, and Bhagavan Krishna is driving the chariot. We have seen in the last class that both the armies have assembled in Kurukshetra. The Pandavas wanting to establish Dharma with the support of Bhagavan Krishna. Bhagavan Krishna is on his side of Pandavas. It's a very stronger side because Bhagavan himself is there. And Kauravas taking the side of Adharma, wanting to destroy Pandavas. And along with Pandavas, they want to destroy Dharma also. So therefore, now the war is between the Dharma and Adharma. Though it is a known fact that war will bring total destruction, total disaster, but compromising on Adharma, it's not proper, it's not correct. Compromise on Adharma will bring total chaos and disorder in the society. And that too for a Kshatriya like Arjuna, waging war to establish Dharma is its duty. It is its duty. And also a great opportunity for a Kshatriya to go to Svargaloka if they die in the war. Bhagavan Krishna himself will say in the Gita, Hatova prapsisi svargam, jitvava mokshase mahi. If you win the war, you will rule the world. The whole world will be yours. If you lose, you will go to Svargaloka. Because being a Kshatriya and waging a war to establish the order in the society, it's a privilege. It's a rare privilege given to Arjuna. So now, the Pandavas, they did not want the war to happen. because they very well know the consequence of the war. It is going to destroy the huge number of people on both sides. And that's what happened also. Therefore, they sent Krishna as the messenger to Duryodhana to negotiate. But however much Krishna tried to negotiate, specify and to avoid the war, but it did not work. Even Bhagavan Krishna was insulted by the arrogant Duryodhana. And in spite of revealing himself as Bhagavan, Krishna could not convince Duryodhana. Krishna could not convince Duryodhana and bring him to the path of Dharma. Therefore, with great difficulty, Dharmaputra, Yudhishthira, he accepted the invitation of Duryodhana to meet in the battlefield. When Duryodhana invited Dharmaputra for playing the game of dice, he gladly accepted. But here, the invitation is for the war. And it is not a pleasant invitation. But what to do could not be avoided. Therefore, the war was decided. So now, when the war was decided, both the Pandavas and the Kauravas, they started gathering armies to fight for them. And Duryodhana, he insisted the support of all the neighboring kingdoms, all the kings who were under him. He gathered the support and their army, and they all had to say yes to him. Because Duryodhana was powerful, and also Duryodhana, he tricked some powerful kings to be on his side also. So many joined on the side of Kauravas because they could not resist the demand of Duryodhana. To resist Duryodhana is opposing adharma, and to oppose adharma, one should be on the side of dharma. Therefore, to be on the side of dharma requires strength. To be on the side of adharma, it doesn't need any strength. But to oppose adharma, really, we need strength. A lot of strength is required. And how many can really follow dharma? It needs a lot of courage. It needs a lot of courage to stick to the path of dharma. In fact, more courage is required to stick to dharma than the courage to fight in the battle. So, many joined the side of Duryodhana. And on the Pandava side, there were less people because they are all for the followers of dharma. That is how in the world also. Always there will be more number of people who follows adharma and less number of people who follows dharma. Therefore, dharma, to protect dharma, we have to protect the dharmis. We have to protect the followers of dharma. Only few followers of dharma are there. So therefore, it is important to protect them. That needs a lot of courage. So dharmic people are really speaking courageous people. And adharmic people, they are not courageous. They are really, in fact, covered. They are cowards. So dharmic people, they have the intention to protect the dharma, to protect the order in the society. Therefore, they think a lot before accepting the war. Now, with no other option available to them, they had to go for war. And both the Kauravas and the Pandava, they collected army. And Pandavas had, or they could collect only 11 Akshohini. Whereas Pandavas had only 7 Akshohini, and Kauravas had 11 Akshohini. Akshohini is a division. It's a division of army. It's a division of army consisting of certain number of chariots, elephants, horses, and infantry, foot soldiers. So they say one Akshohini is equal to 21,870 chariots, 21,870 elephants. 65,610 horses and 1,09,350 foot soldiers. This is one Akshohini. Kauravas had 11 Akshohinis. So we can imagine how many people were there on the side of Kaurava. And on the Pandava side, there were only 7 Akshohini. So you have to add all the numbers, multiply by 18. So many people have gathered now in the Kurukshetra. So the ratio of Kaurava to Pandava is 11:7. 11:7, 11 plus 7, 18. So 18 has got some significance. So 18 is there. So the total number of Akshohini participated in the war is 18. So you can imagine how many people gathered. And at the end of the war, almost all the people were destroyed except a handful of people. So it was a total destruction of the Kuru clan as well as the Pandava also. Only a few people were left out on the Pandava side and also on the Kaurava side. Now the war was announced and they decided to meet in the place of Kurukshetra. As I said before, Kurukshetra is a place, it is located above Delhi, New Delhi. It exists even today between Delhi and Ambala. The founder of the Kuru dynasty, Kuru, his name is Kuru, the great Kuru, he performed tapas in Kurukshetra and established Dharma. Therefore, Kurukshetra is also called Dharma Kshetra. He performed tapas and established Dharma. Therefore, Kurukshetra has got another name, Dharma Kshetra. That is why the Gita also will start Dharma Kshetre, Kurukshetre. It is a Dharma Kshetra. Kshetra means place. Dharma means order. Dharma means order, or Dharma means that which is right. Righteousness, Dharma. So the war was decided and the meeting place is Kurukshetra. And the day of meeting the armies in the battle, that was also decided. See, in those days, there were Yuddha Niyama. There were rules with regard to the battle also. They just cannot bomb each other country and, shoot missiles. It's not like that. They decide when to start the war, which place. And there were other conditions also. They will fight only in the daytime. They will not fight in the night. They will not shoot missiles in the midnight and destroy the whole civilians. There was some order. There was some order with related to the battle also. So when two armies want to meet in the battle, they follow certain code of conduct. Even in Yuddha, Dharma has to be followed. But in Mahabharata, during the war, there were violations of the rules of Dharma. There were violations, but it was followed to a great extent. So from that we can know there were Yuddha Dharma. In those days, there were Yuddha Dharma was there. Even with regard in the battle, there were certain code of conduct followed. If the opponent doesn't have weapon, then the person should not fight with him. He should not shoot any arrow. So that is the conduct, that is a great, that great discipline they had. So now, both the armies had assembled in the battlefield facing each other. The fight had not yet started, it is going to start. One side Pandava, one side Kaurava are standing. And they were waiting for the signals from both sides to commence the battle. So we are in Kurukshetra watching the army standing on both sides now. And you may be remembering that the first 10 days of the war, as described by Sanjaya is the charioteer of Dhritarashtra. we know that the first 10 days of the war was a flashback. The Gita Upadesha is also a description of the flashback of the first 10 days of the war. You may remember what I said in the previous class. That is, when Dhritarashtra, he heard that Bhishma was made to lie on a bed of arrows by Arjuna, then Dhritarashtra got worried and he asked Sanjaya to narrate from the first day of the war. And Dhritarashtra's confidence was on Bhishma and it was shaken because Bhishma now he has made to lie on the bed of arrows. So Dhritarashtra's confidence was shaken by the fall of Bhishma. And Bhishma, the commander in chief of the Kaurava, he was a good person, but he took the side of Duryodhana. Why? Because he had the responsibility to keep up the promise to be on the side of the king of Hastinapura. So therefore, Bhishma fought and Arjuna made him lie on the bed of arrows. So now Dhritarashtra came to know that Bhishma was defeated by Arjuna, and therefore he asked Sanjaya to narrate from the first day of the war. And what happened to Bhishma? Bhishma did not die, because Bhishma, nobody can really defeat Bhishma. Nobody can kill him. Bhishma is invincible. Duryodhana knows very well. That is why he made him the commander-in-chief of the army. And he also knows that he loves Arjuna. He loves Arjuna and other Pandavas. And knowingly that he has given the position of commander-in-chief to Bhishma. And he was a great warrior. Nobody can touch him. He knows very well. And also he had the boon of Ichchamaranam. Ichchamaranam is he can die only when he wants. And therefore, now Duryodhana, now the Bhishma was defeated. So Dhritarashtra got worried and asked Sanjaya to narrate from the first day of the war, which is going to tell. And we have seen who are all the people who took the side of Kaurava. Bhishma was there. First Bhishma was the commander-in-chief. And Dronacharya, another great person, great warrior, he was also on the side of Duryodhana. Though he was the teacher of Dhanurvidya to both the Pandavas and the Kauravas, because he was obliged by Arjuna, the Duryodhana, he took the side of Kauravas. And Kripacharya, another great warrior, he also was made to oblige by Duryodhana and he took the side of Duryodhana. And the Dronacharya's son, Ashwatthama, he was a very good friend of Duryodhana. And Drona was much attached to his son Ashwatthama. And therefore, both of them took the side of Duryodhana. Another important person is there on the Kaurava side. Who is that? Karna. Karna was the dearest friend of Duryodhana. And Duryodhana very well knows the expertise of Karna in handling the bow and the arrow. And Duryodhana believed that Karna was a match to Arjuna in archery. Karna is the only person who can defeat Arjuna. And therefore, all these great people on the side of Kaurava were standing in the battle. And thus, Duryodhana could collect 11 Akshohinis. Whereas Pandava had only 7 Akshohinis. But only strength of the Pandava was Krishna. Krishna is on the side of Pandava. So now, both the group have assembled and war was about to start. And the confidence of Pandavas was on Arjuna, and he was the cynosure of the battlefield. Everybody's eyes was on the Pandava. How he is going to play with this Gandiva? So everybody was waiting to watch the play of Arjuna with this bow and arrow. Arjuna, he had collected many weapons especially for this war. He anticipated this war and collected many weapons like Pashupata Astra from Lord Shiva and many more Astras from Indra and all. So Arjuna with his all his weaponry gadgets, looking so majestic and brave, was standing in the chariot. And his confidence to win the war was multiplied by the presence of Krishna. Bhagavan himself was sitting, driving the chariot, holding the reins of the horses and waiting for Arjuna's command. Arjuna and Krishna, they are friends. But here in the battlefield, Krishna, he accepted to drive the chariot of the Arjuna. And therefore, Arjuna is a master of the chariot now, and Krishna is the driver of the chariot. Though Krishna is the Lord, as the driver, he was waiting for Arjuna's command. He was waiting for the instructions of the Arjuna. And now, Arjuna is waiting. Arjuna, having collected all the weapons, especially for this battle with Duryodhana and Karna, he had got a chance now to display the power of his weapons in action, to display his valor and courage, and also to avenge all his hurts and injustice caused to them by Kauravas. So with all anger and determination to finish off Kauravas, Arjuna with his Gandiva, he was standing with Krishna being seated on the chariot as a driver. So this was the scene of the battlefield. And Kauravas and its allies on one side, Pandava and its allies on the other side. Now, Dhritarashtra is going to ask Sanjaya a question, which is the first shloka of the first chapter. So before getting into the first shloka of the first chapter, that is how the Gita is going to start. From the very mouth of the Dhritarashtra, a verse will come. He will ask a question that is in the form of a verse. That part we will come to it later. But before reading the Gita, very well we know it's a Moksha Shastra, it's a Pramana Shastram. And before starting Gita, there must be prayers. Where is the prayers? And Gita is located in the middle of the Mahabharatam. Therefore, there is no specific prayer written for Gita. We know very well in the tradition, if we take up any text for study, we start with the prayer. The tradition, any text you take, it always starts with the prayer. Without prayer, no text should be studied. Should be started by the author. If any author writes any text without prayer, then it is not considered to be a text at all. And the Sampradaya will dismiss it. Sampradaya will not accept any text written without prayer. Without offering prayers to Ishvara, how can one start anything? And offering prayers before commencing the text, it shows the conformity to the tradition. If you take Upanishads, we have Shantipata. Shantipata is a prayer. Every Upanishad has got its own Shantipata. And any Prakarana Grantha you take, any Vedantic treatise, like even Tattva Bodha is a basic text. It has prayer. The prayer in the form of Ishvara Namaskara or Guru Namaskara or Brahma Namaskara, it is there. Even if you take Vyakarana Shastram, any grammar work, for example, Ashtadhyayi, Panini Sutra Pata, if you take, it also starts with a prayer. You may ask, where is the prayer in Ashtadhyayi? Ashtadhyayi is a Sutra Pata. Sutra Pata means in Sutram, we have to use minimum number of letters, minimum number of words. Minimum number of letters should be in the word. And the words should also be minimum. That is Sutram. How can Sutrapada have prayers? Because when you have a prayer, a lot of words will come, description will come. How can Sutrapada will have prayer? But prayer is there in Sutrapada also. What is the first sutra in Ashtadhyayi? Vriddhi Radhej. Those who know, study Sanskritam, they know very well this sutra. I frequently use, say this sutra. Vriddhi Radhej. Vriddhi, that Vriddhi is the first word in the Sutrapada. Sutra, the first sutra is Vriddhi Radhej. The first word of the first sutra is Vriddhi. That Vriddhi, you know, what are the Vriddhi letters? Vriddhi letters we know. It's a technical word in grammar. But literally Vriddhi means big, greater. Brahma also means Vriddhi only. Bhrugi Vriddhau, if you see the meaning of the word Brahma in Dhatupata, Brahma is Ishvara, Bhagavan. Brahma, if you take the meaning of the word Brahma in Dhatupata, the meaning is Bhrugi Vriddhau. Vriddhau, Vriddhi is a meaning of Brahma also. What does it mean? It means big, greater. That is the meaning. Vriddhi means greater. What is greater? What is the greatest, the limitless? Only Bhagavan. Ishvara is the greatest, the limitless. Therefore, Ishvara is remembered by the word Vriddhi. That is the first word in the sutra part. And the prayer of Panini Magadesh is so effective, that is why the text has survived so many centuries and it has come from generation to generation to us. It has come safely to our hands. And from my hand, I am ready to offer it to you, provided if you are interested in learning Sanskritam grammar. Therefore, what I say is that a prayer is important. And the prayer need not be a long one, but the prayer is important. Even a word or letter can be a prayer. In Ashtadhyayi, in Sutrapata, we saw Vriddhi is a word. It's a prayer. The word itself is a prayer. And similarly, Om, that is also a prayer. Om. And in Brahma Sutra also has got a prayer. Where is the prayer in Brahma Sutra? It is also a sutra work. So where is the prayer in Brahma Sutra? We know Brahma Sutra written by Vyasacharya. It is a text on Vedanta. So what is the first sutra of Brahma Sutra? Athato Brahma Jignyasa. The first sutra is Athato. And the first word of the first sutra is Atha. It starts with Atha. Atha is a prayer. One word prayer. Atha. It is a Mangala Suchaka Shabda. It is the indicator of the auspiciousness. Mangala Suchaka Shabdam. The word. Auspicious word. Omkarashchata Shabdascha Dvaveto Brahmanav Pura Kantam Vitpa Viniryato Tasman Mangali Kavabhau. There is a shloka. Omkara. Om. Omkarascha. Omkarashchata Shabdascha. Omkara and Atha. These two Shabda it came out from the Brahmaji in the beginning of creation. Kantam Vitva Viniryato. It came from the mouth of Brahmaji in the beginning of creation. And therefore, these two words are highly sacred. Om, Atha. Yara Mangala Suchaka Shabda. That is why we always start the class with Om. Om is a prayer. But in Gita, we don't have any prayers. Gita, being located in the middle of Mahabharatam, it cannot have any prayers, specially for Gita, because in the beginning, Vyasacharya has given a prayer. But Gita in the middle, so it cannot have a prayer. And therefore, what we do, we borrow the prayer verses from another text. And the prayer verse, what we chanted now, starting from Parthaya Pratibodhita, all the 9 verses, They are borrowed from another text called Gudartha Deepika. Gudartha Deepika is a text written by Madhusudana Saraswati. Madhusudana Saraswati has written a commentary on Gita, and that is called Gudartha Deepika. Gudartha Deepika, it means a lamp which illumines the deeper meaning of Bhagavad Gita. That is the meaning of Gudartha Deepika. Gudartha Deepika. It's a famous commentary. And Madhusudana Saraswati, before writing the Gudartha Deepika, he has written nine verses as Dhyana Shloka, which are generally recited before studying Gita. So the Dhyana Shloka of Gudartha Deepika has become the Dhyana Shloka of the Gita. That is why we chant the nine Dhyana Shloka. And why do we need a Dhyana Shloka? Why do we need Dhyana Shloka? Why should the author write the prayer verses in the beginning? Because to invoke the grace of Bhagavan for two reasons. One, to complete the text without any obstacles, without any pratibandha. Like we have, especially for our online class, we have a lot of pratibandha. So we need a lot of prayer. So we have to invoke the grace of Bhagavan. And here the author, he writes the prayer verses to invoke the grace of Bhagavan to complete the text successfully without any obstacles. That is one important reason. Second reason is, you have written the text. Now what is the benefit of that? It should be passed on to the people. Then only the benefit is there. The readers should read and they should be benefited from the text. So passing on to the people, passing on to the next generation, so that the generation will benefit. That is the second motive, second reason for the author to write a prayer verse. And in those days, they were using palm leaves. They were using palm leaves for writing. And this palm leaves, they are subject to destruction easily by fire, or it can be eaten by goats. Ajabaksha, Ajabakshita. Many texts we lost because of fire and Ajabakshita. The goats will eat. Therefore, it has to be protected from the goats, protected from the fire, protected from the water. So it needs a lot of grace to protect. That is how we could save so many grantha. We could save so many grantha, and because that itself shows the strength of the prayer of the author. Therefore, for the protection of the text and also for transferring the text to the next generation, to the people, the author offered prayers to Bhagavan in the form of prayer verses, Dhyana Shloka. This is from the side of the author. And from the side of the reader of the text, these prayer verses also has certain significance. Through the prayer verses, we invoke the grace of the Lord so that the reader of the text will be able to complete the text, study the text completely, and also without any obstacles, and also to ward off obstacles that may come while studying. So this is on the side of the people who read the text. So in Bhagavad Gita also, we have Dhyana Shloka, prayer verses that we chant so that we complete the study of Bhagavad Gita in spite of obstacles. In spite of obstacles, we hope that we will be able to complete the study of Bhagavad Gita, and we pray to Bhagavan to ward off all the obstacles that may come in our way, like this internet connection problem and health problem and so many other issues. We pray to Bhagavan so that he may keep away all the obstacles away from us and take us to the path of freedom, moksha. So that is why Dhyana Shloka is very important. So before we get into the first shloka of the first chapter, the context we have seen, we will see the Dhyana Shloka. I will give the meaning of the Dhyana Shloka, what we chant regularly in all the Gita classes. In all the Gita classes, we will be chanting this 9th Dhyana Shloka. It is better to memorize it. And when you keep chanting in every class, you don't have to put any extra effort. Automatically, you will commit this to memory. So let me start with the first Dhyana Shloka. Parthaya Pratibodhitam. It's a famous Dhyana Shloka. So I will chant again. Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Grathitam Purana Munina Adhye Mahabharatam Advaitamrutavarshinim Bhagavatim Ashtadashadhyayinim Ambatvamanusandadhati Bhagavadgite Bhavadveshinim. Beautiful prayer verse. I'll give the meaning of this shloka. Verse, word by word meaning also I will give. If you have a notepad and pen, you can note also. Then I will give I'll explain the meaning of the shloka in detail. So this is a shloka. This is a prayer on Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita herself. Gita is Srilinga. Bhagavad Gita is like Shruti, mother. So therefore, Ehamba. You can see in the last line. Amba Tvam Anusandadhami. Tvam Amba. Amba is O mother, Amba. And Bhagavad Gita, that is also Sambodhana, addressing, calling Bhagavad Gita. O mother, Bhagavad Gita. Amba, Bhagavad Gita. Anusandadhami. Anu Sandadha, Sandadhami. I constantly meditate upon you. I invoke you. Oh, Bhagavad Gita, I invoke. Tvam Anusandadhami. Tvam also, it is there in the last line. Hey, Amba, Bhagavad Gita, Tvam Anusandadhami. I invoke you. Okay. Pratibodhitam. Pratibodhitam. Pratibodhitam is which was taught. Can you all hear me? I got a message that.
Yes, we can hear.
Yes, we can hear.
Okay. If somebody has some problem, fine. Okay. We'll continue. We'll stop with the simple meaning to Dhyana Shloka because the net is not good today. So we'll see the meaning in detail next class. Pratibodhitam, that is in the first line. Pratibodhitam, Parthaya Pratibodhitam. Pratibodhitam is which was taught. For Sanskritam students, Buddha Dhatu becomes Bodhitam. Tapratya, what was taught? Gita was taught. Pratibodhitam, which was taught. Because here we are addressing Gita. So you were taught. I mean, which was taught? Gita was taught. To whom? Arthaya. Chaturthi Bhakti. Gita was taught to Artha. Prithayaha apatyam puman Artha. Son of Pritha. Pritha is Kunti. So Artha. Arthaya Kaunteya. Ityartha. By whom? Bhagavata. Bhagavan. Bhagavan Bhagavanto Bhagavantaha. Bhagavantam Bhagavanto Bhagavataha. Bhagavata. By Lord. Bhagavata. Artaya Pratibodhitam. Hey Humber. O Mother, Bhagavad Gita, Aham, Tvam, Anusandadami, Parthaya, Bhagavata, Pratibhoditam. And who is Bhagavata? Is Narayana. Is Lord Narayana. Bhagavan Narayana. Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam. He himself taught. Narayana himself taught Bharata. What a great privilege. Like Nachiketas himself was taught by Yamadharmaraja. Similarly here, Bhagavan himself taught Arjuna. Narayanena Swayam Bhagavata. Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Bhartaya Pratibodhita. Okay. What? Bhagavad Gita. And who composed this? Gratitam Vyasena. Vyasena Gratitam Purana Munina. Vyasena Gratitam. Gratitam. Granth Dhatu. Grati Dhatu. Gratitam. So which was composed by whom? Vyasacharya. Vyasacharya. And who is Vyasacharya? Purana Munina. Purana could be ancient, old. Muni is Mananashilaha Munihi. Muni means sage. So it could be ancient sage or the one who has written the 18 Puranas. Then by that meaning also we can give Puranam, Purana Munina means the author of the 18 Puranas. That meaning also we can take. One meaning is Purana means ancient, old. Ancient sage, that is one meaning. Other meaning is the author of the 18 Puranas is Vyasacharya, therefore he is called Purana Muni. So Vyasena Purana Munina Vyasena Gratitam. That is Gita. And where it is located? Madhye. Kutra Mahabharat. Mahabharat. Madhye Mahabharatam. In the midst, in the middle of Mahabharata. In the middle of Mahabharata, Gita is located. And it has 18 chapters. Ashtadasha Dhyayini. Ashtadasha Dhyayini. Madhye Mahabharatam. It is located. And it has 18 chapters. Ashtadasha Adhyayini. It has 18 chapters. The collection of 18 chapters is called Ashtadhyayi. Ashtadhyayi means becomes 8 chapters. That is the Sutra Pata. Ashtadhyayi. Collection of 18 chapters. Ashtadashadhyayini. Bhagavad Gita, which consists of 18 chapters. And what is it? Advaita Amrita Varshinim. Advaita Amrita Varshini. When you read Advaita, that should not be paused. Amrita Varshini, it is becomes, it's wrong. Advaita Amrita Varshini together. Advaita Amrita Varshini. It is Amrita, nectar. Nectar Varshini. Varshini means it is showering, pouring. Amrita Varshinim, like Asha Vidya Varshini. Varshini is the shower. What does it shower? Advaita, which is the Amrita. Amrita means moksha. Which is moksha. Moksha means gaining which there is no samsara for you. There is no mrita, there is no death. There is no death. And we are not talking about the physical death. They are talking about samsara. We will not get into samsara once we gain moksha, jnanam. So, Advaita Mrita Varshini. So, it is the giver of moksha in the form of teaching. And the teaching is Advaita. Advaita Mrita Varshini. Bhagavati. Gita is looked upon as goddess. Oh, Bhagavati. Oh, goddess. Bhavadveshini. All these are in Dvitiya Vibhakti. Karma. Bhavadveshini. Bhava is samsara. What is samsara? The life of becoming. And bhavadveshinim, it is the enemy to the life of samsara. What does it mean? It gives moksha. So, therefore, bhavadveshinim, bhagavatim, ashtadashadhyayinim, advaitamritavarshinim, bhagavatim, aham, anusandadami. And this is Vyasa, Bhartaya ప్రతిబోధితాం నారాయణేన స్వయం భగవతా పార్థాయ ప్రతిబోధితాం పురాణమునినా వ్యాసేన కృతితాం. అండ్ వేర్ ఇట్ ఇస్ లొకేటెడ్? మధ్యే మహాభారతం. పురాణమునినా మధ్యే మహాభారతం. పురాణమునినా కృతితాం అండ్ ద లొకేషన్ ఇస్ మధ్యే మహాభారతస్య మధ్యే మహాభారతస్య మధ్యే ఇట్ ఇస్ లొకేటెడ్. అండ్ అష్టాదశాధ్యాయినీం అద్వైతావృతవర్షిణీం భగవతీం అహం అనుసంధదామి. ఐ కాన్స్టెంట్లీ రిపీటెడ్లీ ఇన్వోక్ ది గ్రేస్ ఆఫ్ భగవద్గీత సో దట్ ఐ విల్ గెట్ మోక్ష, ఐ విల్ గెట్ ఫ్రీడమ్, ఐ విల్ గెట్ ది నాలెడ్జ్ ఆఫ్ అద్వైత, ఐ విల్ కమ్ టు నో దట్ ఐఎమ్ నాట్ డిఫరెంట్ ఫ్రమ్ భగవాన్ ఈశ్వర. దట్ ఈస్ అద్వైత అండ్ దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ గీత టీచింగ్ ఇస్. అమృతవర్షిణి గీత. సో ఐ ఆఫర్ మై నమస్కార టు గీత. సో దిస్ ఈస్ అ నమస్కార టు గీత ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్, భగవద్గీత ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్. సో వీఆర్ ఆఫరింగ్ ది నమస్కార టు గీత, లుకింగ్ అపాన్ గీత యాజ్ ది మదర్. శృతి ఈజ్ మదర్, వేదమాత. దర్ఫోర్ గీత, ద టీచింగ్ ఆఫ్ గీత నాట్ డిఫరెంట్ ఫ్రమ్ శృతి. ఇట్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో లుక్డ్ అపాన్ యాజ్ మదర్ అండ్ ఆఫరింగ్ అవర్ నమస్కార టు ది గీత. ఇస్ లైక్ ద మదర్. She saves us from samsara by giving moksha, by giving jnanam. So this is the meaning. You can see the meaning in detail. Probably if you have time today we can do, but I'm not sure about the internet connection, how you all, can you hear me? If my voice clear, then we will continue. Otherwise with this jnana shloka, we have to stop. So should we continue or we can stop now?
Yeah, you can.
Sorry?
We can continue.
Is my voice clear? Is my voice clear?
Yeah, voice is clear.
Okay. So I'll give some
more. I only have the audio. There is nothing, everything is gone. It's just blank screen. It says your microphone is unmuted right now and video okay. Is stopped. That's why it matter. Says.
We can see.
Doesn't matter, only audio is enough because I'm not showing anything in the screen. Only the jnana shloka is there. So I'll explain the meaning. Though I have given
okay, it maybe no? My side. Okay.
Okay. So this jnana shloka, it is a shloka on the mother, the Amba. Who is the mother here? The mother is the Gita. So namaskara to Gita. Gita namaskaraha. That is the first jnana shloka. As I told, this Gita is looked upon as mother. Why? Because Veda itself is considered to be the 1,000 mothers put together. Because it has so much compassion. The Vedas and the Rishis, they have great compassion for human beings and therefore they guide us in revealing the Purusharthas, revealing the Purushartha through the Veda. Veda only reveals the Purushartha. That is why it is called Veda. Chaturveda Purushartan Anena Iti Vedaha. Therefore it is Veda. So, Dharmartha Kama Moksha. The Purusharthas are known only through the Veda. In fact, there are no four, only one, that is moksha. Moksha is what is really we expect, we want from all other pursuits. Therefore, and that moksha is revealed only by the Veda and the Gita. So, therefore, like a mother, Gita also is highly compassionate and it takes us towards moksha by making us leading the life of dharma. Therefore, it is looked upon as mother. And here Madhusudana Saraswati, he looks upon Gita as a mother. as Gita has the same compassion as the Veda to teachers and guiders in the path of moksha. Therefore, he addresses, E Amba Bhagavad Gita, O Mother Bhagavad Gita. Swam Anusandadami, we have seen. I constantly invoke you, meditate on you. Okay. And this Gita, it presents the teaching the same way as the Veda. So here, Gita takes into account the two types of people. Two types of people, one who really come to the conclusion that their only pursuit is moksha, and they have come to Vedanta. Therefore, that Vedanta alone gives freedom. They have come to the conclusion, having done pariksha lokan, having examined the loka, they have come to the conclusion that knowledge alone gives moksha, and all the karmas have got limited ends. They are only a secondary cause for moksha. They know. Secondary cause, what I mean is, it doesn't take directly to moksha. Like any karma you do, the karma has got limited results. The karma may give conducive ambience to pursue moksha. Like you can go to Brahma Loka. There also you can go and pursue the moksha, provided if you have the same sadhana chatushtayam, the commitment to be free. If the commitment to be free is there, then the moksha is there. So Gita takes into consideration both the people. That is why jnana yogena sankhyanam karma yogena yoginam. Gita itself prescribes teaching for the people who are committed to two different lifestyles, like the Veda. So that we will see in detail. It is going to come in the form of teaching of Karma Yoga. The form of Karma Yoga. So therefore, like a mother knows where the child is, how the child is now, which stage of the life the child is now. The mother knows. What does it need? The mother knows. What to feed the child? The mother knows. Therefore, like a mother, it presents the teaching. Therefore, Madhusudan Saraswati, he addresses Gita as Hey Amba, Bhagavad Gita. As I told before, if you remember, it should be Gitam. Why it is Gita? Because Veda is, it's called Shruti. Shruti is Strilinga. And therefore, Gitam also became Gita, Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavataha Gita, Bhagavad Gita, the song of Bhagavan. Song doesn't mean singing. The teaching of Bhagavan, Bhagavad Gita, and that itself looked upon as the mother. Okay. And it was taught to Partha. Who is Partha? Arjuna. And he is called Kaunteya. Kuntya. Kuntyaha putraha or Pratayaha putraha. Prita is the name, another name of Kunti. So son of Prita. Who is that? Partha. Arjuna. Therefore, Arjuna has got the name Partha because he is a son of Prita. Prita is the name of Kunti. Therefore, Partha. To Partha, this Gita was taught by Bhagavan. If Partha was not there, then Gita would not have come. If Partha had not asked Bhagavan to teach, then Gita would not have come. And Partha, that is Arjuna and Bhagavan, Krishna, both were only friends. Both were only friends. They have not become the guru disciple. Krishna had not taken the position of guru yet because they are sitting in the battle. Arjuna with his Gandiva is standing on the chariot, and Krishna is ready to take Arjuna to the forefront. So they are friends. Now Krishna is just a driver. They have not yet become guru disciple. That transformation, that from the relationship of friendship to guru-disciple relationship, that transformation is going to happen. That you will see. So beautiful. then only Krishna takes a position of the guru and teaches Arjuna. Then Arjuna is no more a friend, he is a disciple. Therefore, Parthaya Pratibhoditam. When you say Bhoditam, then there should be a guru-disciple relationship. Without the guru-disciple relationship, there cannot be any bodhana, there cannot be any teaching. For teaching to take place, there should be a guru. The person should take the position of the guru. That is why it is called Vyasapita. The Pitam is Vyasapitam. The seat is Vyasapita. Because only guru can sit on the Vyasapita and the Shishya can listen to the words of the guru. So Krishna is going to take that Vyasapita and becomes a guru and teaches Arjuna. And therefore, Parthaya, this Gita was taught to Arjuna, therefore, Parthaya Prati Bodhitam. Okay, and taught by whom? The one Krishna. And who is Krishna? This Krishna is not the Krishna whom you saw in Vrindavan, playing with the gopis. That Krishna is different. This Krishna is Bhagavan Krishna. That is also Bhagavan Krishna only. But here, Bhagavan is a bit more serious. Because he's going to give the teaching, the means for moksha, the knowledge which gives moksha. That is what Bhagavan is going to give. Therefore, Bhagavan, Swayam Bhagavan, Narayanena. Bhagavan Narayana himself, it's not an ordinary guru. Bhagavan Narayana himself is going to teach. Okay. So the word Naraha, the word from the word Naraha, only Narayana comes. It is interesting to know the meaning, the derivation, the etymology of the word Narayana. Nara means a human being. Nara can refer to human being, but it can also mean that which cannot be destroyed. Nariyate. Nariyate iti Naraha. That which cannot be destroyed is called Naraha. So here, that which cannot be destroyed is not the physical body we are talking about. Here it refers to the Atma Chaitanyam. That Atma Chaitanyam, the consciousness, that is the essence. That is the essence of the Karta. That is the essence of Karta, Bhokta, the doer, enjoyer. And that is called Nariyate, it is Atma. So Nara can also mean Atma. How do we know all those meanings? Only from the Shastra. Therefore, Nara can also mean here Atma, Paramatma. So that is Narayana. So Narasya idam Naram. Narasya idam Naram. Like Rishihe idam Arsham. So the word Arsha, Arsha Vidya. Arsha Vidya Varshini. Arsha, the word comes from the word Rishi. By adding a particular suffix, it's called Taddita, Pratyaya, you get the word Arsham. Similarly, from the word Nara, which means Paramatma, you get the word Narasedam Naram. Nara, the word Nara comes from the word Nara. And the path which takes you to Naram, Ayanam, that path is called Ayanam. That becomes Nara, Ayanam becomes Narayanam. Naram eti gachati iti Narayana. Eti could be here, gachati or avagachati. Naram eti avagachati iti Narayana. The one who knows this Nara. This Nara could be the subject, the essence of the subject, or could be the entire Jagat. Jagat is the Bhagavan. So therefore, the whole world is Narayana, Parameshwara. So that meaning also can be taken. The one who knows the entire world includes himself also. The essence of the Karta, essence of the Karta, Bhokta, the Jiva, being Atma. The one who knows Atma, the one who knows the Jagat is Narayana. In short, Narayana means the one who knows everything. One is omniscient. Omniscient includes the knowledge of both the Jagat, and when you say Jagat, it includes oneself also. So that means Narayana, Paramatma, Ityartha, Parameshwara. That is the meaning, Narayana. So, Narayana is the one who knows everything. That Narayana, Bhagavan, who is that? Krishna, Swayam, Swayam Pratibodhitam. Narayanena Swayam Pratibodhitam. Okay. And here, who is the author of this great text, Mahabharata, Vyasa. So, taught by Krishna, heard by Arjuna, and reported by Vyasa. And Vyasa, as I told, is a Purana Muni. Muni means Manana Shilaha. Muni is Manana Shilaha. That it means one who has the ability to dwell on a topic for a length of time. That is called Manana Shila. That is called Muni. So Purana Muni. The literal translation of the word Muni means Rishi or sage. So Purana Muni, the ancient sage, and also being the author of the 18 Puranas, so Vyasa. Okay. And what does it teach, Gita? Gita teaches, according to us, our Siddhanta is Advaita. Our Siddhanta is Advaita. So we say it teaches Advaita, non-duality. Because to teach duality, we don't need any teaching. Duality we know from the very beginning of our birth. From the very beginning we know, we have the experience of subject and object. I am the subject and the whole Jagat is the object. I am the poor one subject as to handle, have to handle the whole gamut of objects. So many people are there, so many persons are there, so many objects are there, situations in life. I am the only subject, have to handle the object. The Jagat is the object, I am the subject. So already the duality is there. I am is there, and anything other than I am, that is the object, it is there. That is duality. Duality, already it is known. Why should it be taught? Aham Jivatma, Aham Jivaha, anything other than me is not me, that I know it. Should I need any special teaching to understand this duality, Dvaitam? That cannot be the teaching of the Shastra. It's a known fact. It is obvious. And therefore, if Shastram has to teach something, it's being a Pramana. It is being a Pramana, therefore it has to teach something, though it looks obvious, this duality, that Shastra will negate that. In spite of duality being there, the reality is Advaita. The reality is non-duality. No difference between me and the Jagat. Between me, the subject, and the object. That is the teaching of Advaita. Swamiji used to tell a story. The story part I will tell you later. It's very interesting about this learning duality. There's nothing to learn duality. Our orientation from the beginning itself is duality. So, what is that to learn in duality? If Shastram has to teach, it should be non-duality, Advaita. In Advaita, there is no second thing. All the differences between Jagat, Ishvara and me, it's all resolved. And there is no difference. Non-difference is the teaching. Non-difference, understanding the non-difference, non-duality alone takes away the fear, the bhaya of samsara from me. And that is alone is moksha. And that is what the teaching of Bhagavad Gita. And that is the nectar. That is the amrita. Therefore, Advaita, Amrita. Advaita and Amrita both goes together. Because that which is Dvaitam is Mritam. That which is Dvaitam is Mritam. When there is Dvaitam, duality, there is fear. There is fear is there, bhayam is there. When duality is there, then I cannot be free because there will always be something which is bigger than me. There is another second object which limits me and I don't want to be limited. If I don't want to be limited, then whom I should be? I should be limitless. That is the truth. That is the reality that I don't know. I know only duality. And therefore, Shastra has to teach the non-duality. Shastra being the Pramanam, that is the teaching of the Shastra. How it is presented, that is the prakriya, the method which are adopted in the Advaita system. So, that Advaita is the teaching of Bhagavad Gita, and that is what is referred by the word Advaita Amrita. And Varshini, it showers. It doesn't just say simply the Mahavakyam. It's going to present the Mahavakyam, the great equation that you are the cause of this Jagat. You are Ishvara, the cause of this Jagat. And there is no difference between you and Ishvara. Jivatma Paramatma Yogo Vedaha Nasti Avedaha Avedaha. And that alone removes the cause of fear, Bhaya Vinashaha. And that is the Karavan Guru of Samsara, Bhavad Dveshinim. Therefore, Gita is Bhavad Dveshinim. Because it teaches non-duality, because it teaches, gives me Amritatvam, therefore, it is destroys the Samsara. Samsara is, I want to become something, that is Samsara. I am not happy with what I am now, because I am limited. I feel insecure. I want happiness. There is always a lack in me. And that lack is because of ignorance. And the ignorance has to go. That ignorance will go only in the wake of jnanam. Jnanam of what? Jnanam of understanding that there is no difference between me and Ishvara. And that knowledge alone removes samsara. Therefore, bhavat dveshini, enemy to the life of becoming, that is samsara, that is Gita, that is the teaching of Gita. So Gita is a remover, is a destroyer of samsara. And to that Gita, I offer my namaskara. Anusandadami, I repeatedly invoke. Why I repeatedly invoke? It is not that Gita should be studied only once. One time study itself will take time. But the teaching is to be contemplated upon again and again. Therefore, I meditate on the Gita, the mother, repeatedly. I constantly invoke the Gita so that the teaching will get into me and remove my ajnanam and gives me the moksha and gives me complete freedom. Freedom from the sense of fear, freedom from insecurity, and freedom for searching for happiness. Because I am that, I am already incomplete, I am incomplete is the problem. So the knowledge I am complete, that gives me the moksha, that keeps me fearless. And that removes the samsara. That is the teaching of Bhagavad Gita. And that Gita only, in the form of a mother, gives. Therefore, I constantly invoke Gita. To that Gita, I offer my namaskara. This is the prayer of Madhusudana Saraswati to Gita. So the beautiful words, what a beautiful meaning. So, I will chant once. You also can chant with me. And the second Dhyana Shloka onwards, you can see it in the next class. So this Shloka, you can try to memorize it. Parthaya Pratibodhitam.
Parthaya Pratibodhitam.
Bhagavata.
Bhagavata.
Narayanena Svayam.
Narayanena Svayam.
Vyasena Gratitam Purana Munina.
Vyasena Gratitam Purana Munina.
Madhye Mahabharatam.
Madhye Mahabharatam.
अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं
भगवती
अष्टादशाध्यायिनी अम्बत्वा मनुसंदधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी Okay, we'll continue from the second Dhyana Shloka in the next class. It will take one or two classes to complete all the Dhyana Shloka. Then we'll get into the first chapter of the Gita. Om Purnamadah
Namadah Purnamidah Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamiva Avashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti
Hari Om
Guru Guru Namah Hari
Om
धन्यवाद
शरण जी कैन आई आस्क अ क्वेश्चन
या प्लीज
दिस इज नॉट रिलेटेड टू द करंट क्लास टू द टुडेज क्लास बट आई वॉज वेरी क्यूरियस